try to make it out alone without your help. But I know I'll never win this war. I can never be, never be free without you. I can never be, never be me without you. This is the sound of chains breaking. This is the beat of a heart changing. This is the song of a soul. Freedom in knowing my life is better off in your hands. The past is gone, what's done is done. Now I'm alive and I'm never gonna look back. I can never be, never be free without you. I can never be, never be me without you. This is the sound of chains breaking. This is the beat of a heart changing. This is the song of a soul forgiving. This is my freedom hymn.
Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Walter. I'm one of the pastors here at Holmes Avenue. I'm grateful that you would worship with us this morning. As we begin, want to begin to orient our hearts and minds towards the Lord in this time. And first and foremost, if you're a guest with us, would encourage you to scan the QR code you'll see on the screen. Let us know that you're here. Tell us what God is doing in your journey with Him. Also want to remind you, if you are wanting to contribute to the mission here at Holmes Avenue, you can look at the following slide, you can scan the QR code, you can text in, you can give as you exit. There are a variety of ways for you to give to support the mission at Holmes Avenue. A portion of those funds goes towards special offerings like the Janie Chapman offering that you'll hear more about today, where we are supporting mission work both here in South Carolina and around the world. And you'll hear more about that at the end of our service, but I want you to know that what you give makes a difference. Finally, as we do each week, we want to begin with our New City Catechism to prepare our hearts and minds to worship through this catechism we've prepared. And so we're looking at question 37, and a question is given to us is, how does the Holy Spirit help us? And as we do each week, I want to invite you to read the answer with me. The answer that's provided to us is, the Holy Spirit convicts us of our sin, comforts us, guides us, gives us spiritual gifts and the desire to obey God, and He enables us to pray and to understand God's Word. The incredible thing about the Holy Spirit is that first it gives us life, that as we trust in Jesus, we've been transformed through the work of the Spirit, and so we have life. And as if that's not enough, the Spirit then comes and dwells inside of us, giving us the ability to be filled, to be fulfilled in this life. And beyond all that, as if those things weren't enough, then it gives us the ability to look towards the one who has saved us, Jesus, to understand His Word, to pray and to communicate, to be a part of His earthly kingdom. The Holy Spirit brings so many blessings to us, and a part of what it brings to us is the ability to really, truly worship God. And so today, we have an opportunity to worship the Lord as we proclaim His greatness through song. I want to pray for us, and then we can together worship the Father. Would you pray with me? Lord, we're grateful for You. We're thankful for the gift of the Holy Spirit, Lord, that You've sent this very member of the Trinity, this holy, divine God, to be a part of us. Lord, that the Spirit dwells inside of us, giving us life, filling us, giving us fulfillment on this earth, Lord, and leading us to find Jesus everywhere we go. Lord, this is an incredible gift that Jesus proclaimed that it would be better that He would go away so that this Spirit could come and dwell in us. Lord, let us not forget all that You've done for us. This gift of the Spirit, Lord, the works You're doing in this world, Father, all the things that You're bringing together, these are good, beautiful things that we are grateful for. And Lord, today as we come to worship You, we recognize that we have things that we are grateful for and things that we are in sorrow over. And so, Lord, wherever we are in this spiritual journey, whether we're experiencing joy or sorrow, would You let us experience Your presence today? May we feel You are near to the brokenhearted, and may we feel that You are near to those that You love. May we rejoice clearly and loudly of Your grace and mercy, proclaiming all that You've done, and through worshiping You, may our hearts be softened to the movement of the Spirit, to the work of the Word, Lord. And may we proclaim Your majesty, truly being transformed by the power of the gospel. Lord, we're thankful for You, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Would you stand and worship with us?
I remember those melodies, those words we sang when I first believed. Songs of redemption, stories of hope, heaven awakened inside my soul. And I sing in Christ alone, my solid ground. Amazing grace, oh how sweet the sound. On that rugged cross, Jesus. Jesus paid it all because he lives. This is my song. He's like a river, love so divine. Those words kept singing through the darkest nights. Sweet hymns of freedom, anthems of praise, remind my heart to trust his name. In Christ alone, my solid ground, amazing grace, oh how sweet the sound. On that rugged cross, Jesus paid it all because he lives. This is my song. Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Blessed assurance, glory divine, oh hallelujah, Jesus is mine. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Blessed assurance, glory divine, oh hallelujah, Jesus is mine. Yeah, in Christ alone, my solid ground, I said amazing grace, oh how sweet the sound. On that rugged cross, Jesus paid it all because he lives. This is my song. I sing in Christ alone.
Come on.
My solid ground, amazing grace. Oh, how sweet the sound. On that rugged cross, Jesus paid it all because he lives. This is my song. Because he lives, this is my song. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Amen. Give God some praise this morning. How many of you are happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's keep praising him. We sing, we're creation.
And we're creation, suddenly articulate. With a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we be Christ, be magnified.
The whole earth.
Sing.
We're the whole earth, echoing his imminence. Oh, his name would burst through sea and sky. And from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified.
I want to hear every voice this morning lift it up. Let's sing together. Christ be magnified.
And oh, Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise, Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be Christ be magnified in me. Oh, no. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry, and then in one enraptured hymn of praise we'll sing Christ be magnified.
You sing it this way, we sing.
In all Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified.
That's right.
In me. Magnified, the author of my life, Christ be magnified in me.
I want to go into this bridge and I want to sing it, and I want to believe it, speak it over our lives, and live it. Let's sing this together. I won't bow to idols.
No, and I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there to win. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. If I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and saints, my heart will still be singing, my soul will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. And oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
One more time, we sing.
Oh, Christ be magnified.
You sing it.
Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me.
And oh,
let Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me.
How good is Jesus, y'all?
Lost without hope, no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested, my life began. And ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested, my life began.
Singing out of your grace.
know your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you.
Yes, it does.
It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. My chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested, my life began. Our Savior displayed on that criminal's cross. And then darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Over me, you have made me new. Now life begins with you.
Sing it just in this love this morning.
It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you.
Everyone, this morning, how we're free. We sing,
oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song of all the
free.
Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my eyes began, oh, we're free, free, forever we're free. Come join the song. All the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested, my life began. When death was arrested, my life began. When death was arrested, my life began. Know your grace so washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with Jesus. You.
Thank you, Father. No.
It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us.
One more time together.
Know your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless down on us. You have made us new. Now life begins with you.
Lord, thank you so much. Thank you, God. Thank you, Father, for your grace that you give to us, not by anything we've done, but the free gift of your grace is salvation through Christ. Lord, thank you for allowing us to have that grace, for giving that grace to us so that we can live every day for you. Lord, we love you. And this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen, amen. Yeah, y'all can clap, amen. Aren't you grateful we're free? Amen? So thankful for that time of worship this morning. And we'll introduce him a little bit further to you in a little while, but that's Corey. And he stepped in and helped us, helped us lead this morning. Sierra and Zach are enjoying a little time in Boston together. So y'all pray for them. They're currently in the air, traveling out to Boston. So keep them in your prayers this week. And Zach is super, super excited. And this is their first time away from Davie. So y'all just pray for Sierra as she navigates through that. But they're excited about this time away together. Before we move into our time of sermon this morning, looking at the word, we're going to go to our pastoral prayer, and I did a little punt than what I had planned to pray for this morning. There is just a lot of sickness and a lot of just that's kind of going on in our church family right now. Just a lot of people are hurting. A lot of people are just waiting for answers. A lot of people are just in need of prayer. And so I want to lift up our church family right now as we go to the Lord in prayer. So would you pray for me, or pray with me this morning? You can pray for me too, but pray with me. Father in heaven, Lord, we are so grateful for you. We're so thankful, Lord, of the words of these songs that we have sung to you this morning. We're so thankful, Father, at the truth that death has been arrested, Lord, because of the finished work of the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, and his precious blood that was poured out in our place on Calvary's cross. We praise your name, Lord, that he resurrected from that grave, and he's ascended into heaven, and he sits at your right hand until the appointed time where you send him back, Father. We thank you, Lord, for, as we said during the catechism, the Holy Spirit, the promised one, Lord, that you promised to send, the helper that indwells every single believer who calls upon the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being our guide. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for convicting us of sin, for being our comforter, our helper in time of need. And Lord, I feel like right now is one of those times for our people. Lord, there have been many things this week, especially, of sickness, of trying to figure out answers to medical questions, of just going through difficulty of painful sickness that has happened to some people and leaving questions of what happens next. And Lord, in the midst of all of that, there's a constant. That constant is you. You never leave us, nor do you forsake us. You are there in the midst of our hurting. You are there in the midst of our questioning. You are there in the midst of our wondering, where are you? You're there in the midst of our suffering. The scriptures are clear that suffering is good for us because it draws us closer to you. That sounds so counter to what the world would tell us, Lord, but it's the reality. Because of the result of this fallen world that we're in and sin being present, Lord, there are things that we experience in this life that wasn't originally designed to be. But Lord, for those who are in Christ that have been redeemed by that precious blood of Jesus, we know you intimately. We know you as our Abba Father. We know that you are in the midst of the trials, right there beside us. There may be times, Lord, that we feel like we don't know where you are. And the whole time you're there, oh my child, I'm right here with you. Father, thank you for being who you are. Lord, we pray for answers. Lord, we pray for restoration. Lord, we pray for repentance where necessary. Lord, we pray ultimately in all things, Lord, that your will would be done here on earth, here at Holmes Avenue, as it is in heaven. Lord, now as we are about to open your word and study this passage from Galatians 2, Lord, I pray, God, that all distractions would be minimized. Lord, that the things that maybe are on our minds, those things that are heavy and weighing, Lord, that we would place them at the foot of the cross right now. And Lord, that we would allow that time to be set aside so that we can hear from you. We open the pages of your scripture as the word is read audibly, Lord. That is your word speaking back to us. It is your God-breathed word. So, Lord, as it is proclaimed today, speak to our hearts. Lord, as it is proclaimed, be with me as I proclaim your word this morning. Anything of this that is of me, get it out of the way. I want to be your vessel. I want to say the things that you would have me say. Holy Spirit, guide my words. Holy Spirit, speak. And Lord, above all things, I pray that you would have your way in us today. Pray this in your heavenly and precious name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, well, if this is your first time with us or first time in a little while, we are continuing to journey through the book of Galatians in our series Unburdened, and this has been a great study so far. We are now in week 4 of our fall preaching series. We are going to be in this up until Advent, and it is going to be a continual great time of studying. And I've entitled the message today, as you can see on the screen, Gospel Clarity. Gospel Clarity. And I said a moment ago, we're in chapter 2, we're in verses 11 through 21 here this morning. And many of us have probably been to the eye doctor before, right? Many of us. Some of us very recently. I went just a few months ago with Adeline, and we go together for our annual appointment, and much to life events and things going on, we were already like 4 to 5 months past when we should have been there for our annuals. And as I went in there, I went in wearing a pair of glasses and that prescription that I had had for 3 years already. And so I was definitely in need of some new glasses, and I was definitely in need of some new prescriptions, because I'm getting older and I can see very clearly when I don't have my glasses on that I desperately need them more and more. And so as we go in there, you've probably experienced this if you've been to the eye doctor. They do your exam, they look and make sure your eyes are healthy, and then my doctor, Dr. Smith, comes in and he takes that machine and he puts it there in front of my eyes. And he does it so that he can get a correct prescription for my right eye and for my left eye so that I, in turn, can have either contacts or glasses. I don't like contacts, so I go with the glasses. But as we're sitting there, they have the chart up there on the screen, and he doesn't put the glasses machinery there on my face yet, and he says, okay, read what you see. And I got the first letter on the top line, and then I had nothing. I'm like, doc, when I first started coming to you, I could at least see the second line without anything. I can't even see that right now. Meanwhile, Adeline and Noah are there with me, and Noah's just laughing because Daddy can't figure it out. But I'm trying to read, and I'm like, doc, I got nothing. Well, he takes that machine, and he goes and says, all right, we'll try now. And he starts to tweak and put some things in, and, oh, I can start to see a little bit, okay? And he goes, all right, try this now. And he pushed the button, and then it changed it. And I'm like, okay, that's better. And he goes, all right, I think this is the one. And he pushes it. And it's like, I can see clearly now. Like, it's picture perfect. Okay, Doc, I can start reading these lines to you. And I got all the way down to the last line. I was like, hot dog, I'm pretty good, right? He goes, yeah, your prescription has definitely needed to be changed. And so that machinery that he uses to figure out the prescription for my eyes, before that thing was placed in front of my vision, I couldn't see clear. All I could see was a blurry letter that I barely got right, and then the rest I could not see. But the moment he took the corrective lens prescription and put it there in front of my eyes, I could see clear. What am I getting at with this story? When we have the gospel, the good news of Jesus, and the word of God in our lives, and we have people that come alongside of us and help us to point the reality of Scripture to us, it helps us to see clearly. It gives us clarity to this life. See, today, Paul addresses the fact that he comes and he has to have a little bit of a confrontation with Peter. In our scriptures, it says Cephas, that's Peter. And when he's having this confrontation, he's bringing to light some sinful issues that Peter has done. And then he's going to address the clarity, understanding of salvation for us. So our bottom line today is this: the gospel brings clarity to all things. The gospel brings clarity to all things. Our first point, I hope you're taking notes, is this: clarity of sin. Clarity of sin. Let's read chapter 2, verse 11. But when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face because he stood condemned. He stood condemned. Paul's addressing the fact that Peter, one of the apostles, and you got to think in this moment, like, Paul's still the new guy. Paul's the guy that was the persecutor of Christians that's now been redeemed, and he's being used by God to take the message to the Gentiles. He's his chosen instrument, as God said to Ananias in Acts 9, for Paul to be sent out to do the work that he's called him to. But he says that he opposes Peter to his face. For that to happen, there's got to be some serious problems happening, okay? He's being bold and he's going forward, which is great. Make note of that. But he's also coming and he's doing this very directly and publicly. Look at verse 12. For before certain men came from James, he was eating with the Gentiles. And when they came, he drew back and separated himself, fearing the circumcision party. Now we see the reason for Paul's confronting of Peter. This is the same guy, Peter, who in Acts 10 is brought by the Lord to go to Cornelius' house and proclaim the gospel to them. To make clear, like, this is Peter. He's doing a good work, but wait a second. Now Paul's addressing something that he's not doing right. You might be saying, well, what was the big deal for Peter? Yeah, the circumcision party, the Jewish guys, they come up, but what's the big deal that he kind of backed off and didn't eat with them? Well, he's afraid when he sees them. See, this is the exact opposite response of our Lord Jesus. Why? Because you have to remember, Peter is sitting there and he's eating with the Gentiles, the ones that are included now because of the new covenant. The ones who, when the gospel is taken out, it goes to the ends of the earth for the Gentiles, i.e. us. And so because the Lord Jesus has established a new covenant because of his sacrifice, there should be no ill will towards one certain group. There shouldn't be no favoritism, no partiality shown. But Peter's fearful when they come up. He doesn't want the Jewish guys to see him hanging out with the Gentiles. Now, I said a moment ago, that's the exact opposite of our Lord Jesus. Why? We know when we go through the Gospels, we read the accounts of what Jesus did. He hung out with tax collectors. He hung out with sinners. He hung out with the least of these. He hung out with the people that nobody wanted anything to do with. That was his purpose. He could care less what anybody had to say about him or what he was doing. Recall with me this one example from Mark 2 from the calling of Levi. He went out again beside the sea, and all the crowd was coming to him, and he was teaching them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he rose and he followed him. And as he reclined at a table in the house, many tax collectors and sinners were reclining with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. And the scribes and the Pharisees, remember the bigwigs at the time, when they saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, said to his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" And when Jesus heard it, he said to them, this is very important, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." Our Lord Jesus is making it clear there in that moment to the religious elite, I don't care what you have to say in this regard. I didn't come for the righteous. I didn't come for those who knew all the answers. I didn't come for those who at least appeared right. Granted, they had some heart problems, so they're in that sinner category. Jesus is making it clear, like, the purpose of why I came was for those who are sick, those who are separated from God. This is my purpose. And if the Lord Jesus is our example to us today as we read the scriptures, he is obviously an example to Peter. And that's why it's so serious for Paul to confront him here and bring out the clarity of his sin. Look at verse 13. "And the rest of the Jews acted hypocritically along with him, so that even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy." You see, that's what Jesus did, was hang out and care for those that no one else wanted to, the sinners, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, you fill in the blank. Yet Peter doesn't do this. Peter has a moment of making a decision, and he chooses it wrongly. Peter acts hypocritically. And make very important note about this. As he does this, the scriptures tell us that the others that were there with him started to act hypocritically as well. The scriptures tell us right here that even Barnabas did it too. If you don't remember who Barnabas is the encourager. Barnabas is a man of God, and yet even here in this moment, he sees Peter, one of those apostles, sitting there before him, and he sees how Peter treats the Gentiles as the Jewish come up, the circumcision party. And he backs off hypocritically, and they do the same. Let's make a little side note here. If we're not careful how we lead our lives, the people that are in our lives that look to us to be an example, if we're going hypocritically the wrong way, they will follow suit. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. If God has placed you in somebody's life, in a group of people's life, and they know you follow Jesus, they may even be infants in Christ, young believers. If they see you going down a path, they're going to assume, well, wait a minute now, if he or she can do that, I need to do the same. And if we're not careful, we will very quickly take people down the wrong path that leads to destruction, because it's sinful. Does anything good come from sin? Absolutely not. It's destructive. We have to be careful. We must demonstrate the way in which we are to live, and that is to bring God glory, to walk in obedience. So therefore, we must keep close watch on ourselves so that we don't lead others astray. Now, when we get to verse 14, Paul packs a punch. He brings the heat. "But when I saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas before them all, 'If you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and do not like a Jew, how can you force the Gentiles to live like Jews?'" Let's break that down for a moment. We see here that Paul first says that he saw that their conduct was not in step with the truth of the gospel. They were not living the way of Jesus, following the way, and so therefore he knew, uh-oh, there's a problem here. So I have got to address this. He then sees there that Paul confronts Peter publicly. It says in front of them all. This is serious business. Paul's not going to wait and say, hey, Peter, can we go over and talk over here? Let's get some coffee and go do this here. Now, there's a time and a place for that. But here in this moment, as Peter is doing this, and everyone else is following after him hypocritically, Paul has to address it right there on the spot. And he does it there in front of them all. He's letting them know that although he was a Jew by birth, he discarded the Jewish law and lived like a Gentile under the new covenant. So why try and make the Gentiles follow a Jewish tradition, i.e. circumcision? Jesus paid the price for all sin. Thus, anyone who is ready and willing to repent of their sin and confess Jesus Christ as Lord, what? They are saved. There is no one way or another anymore in that regard. Jesus paid the price for all sin. Therefore, the laws of the Jews weren't needed. The legalism did not need to be available to them anymore. They didn't need to follow every set of rules. Remember, if we had to follow the law, who in here would keep the law perfectly? Exactly. We cannot meet the measure of the law, the standard that God has placed there. It goes all the way back to the book of Exodus when we see the Ten Commandments. He establishes the law and he says, this is how my people should live. And so we read through that and we see that and we say, there's no way I can do that. I'm doomed. But God already knew that we would be doomed. God already knew that we would not be able to meet that standard that is set so profoundly before us. And so he sent the one who meets every bit of it. The perfect, spotless Lamb of God, his son, King Jesus, to pay the price for us. Thus, arresting death, as we said a moment ago in our song. See, Peter doesn't need to give in to the fear of what the Jews may think. His primary concern should be to glorify God by the way he lived and he treated others. What about you and I? Do we live our lives in a manner that shows partiality to one or another? Think about that for a moment. Chew on that. Our immediate response may be, no, I don't. But think about it. Let's just give an example. What happens when we're driving and we pull up to a traffic light and we see a homeless person standing there on the corner? What's our immediate response? What's our thought when we see somebody that doesn't necessarily live a lifestyle like we would want to live, that we would expect people to live, and we see them living a different way? What's our immediate response? What happens inside of us? Do we get frustrated? Do we begin to say condescending things to ourselves? What happens if we're in a place and there's a group of people this way that follow the way of Jesus and that model that, but then we see somebody that obviously doesn't? Are we more prone to say, oh, I ain't going over there. Let me hang out with my crew here. Or are we one of the only ones that say, you know what, crew? Y'all got it right. I'm going over here. I need to pour into this person. I need to love on this person. I need to care for this person. I need to show them the way of Jesus. Do we fear what others may think if we pour our lives into those who aren't living godly lives? Do we care? I would dare say don't. Don't care what others may think. If there are people that you know who are far from the Lord and they may not walk in a way that you want to live, they are the very people that Jesus came for. And they are the very people that he's called us to run to, not away from. But we are so prone and so quick to see them and we say, yo, I got to get out of the way. And come up with any kind of way. And I'm not just preaching here, I'm talking to myself as well. It's been a convicting passage this week. Here's the other reality, church. If we see sin in each other, this is where it gets heavy. If we, in the body of Christ, see sin in our brother, in our sister, we don't just let it go. We confront it. We do it in a God-honoring, God-loving way. But we don't just let it pass. Because if we just let it pass, we're throwing that person out in drowning water without a life preserver. We're just letting them go. They are our brother or our sister in Christ. They need us to come alongside of them, to confront them in their sin, and prayerfully see them be restored. We're commanded in Scripture, it says, to confess your sins to one another. James chapter 5, verse 16. Confess your sins to one another and do so without fear, to build one another up, to encourage, to allow the gospel to confront sin, to restore and to bring glory to God. Because here's the reality, much like the example of the glasses when they went on my blind eyes to be able to see, and it was clear for me, when we hit the issues in our lives where there is sin that is present, in a brother or sister, in our lives, if somebody comes to us and says, hey, I see this sin, there's this issue, they're bringing the truth of the gospel to us, and it takes those blinders off, and it helps us to see the issues that we have. And it allows the Lord to open the door to minister to our hearts that so desperately need it. We can't do life alone. We must do life with one another. Allow the gospel to show the clarity of sin. Secondly, the clarity of salvation. Clarity of salvation. Let's read 15 and 16 together. Paul continues, we ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ, so that we also have believed in Christ Jesus in order to be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law. Because by works of the law, no one will be justified. There's a lot of theological terms being thrown out there. Let's break it down. Paul confronts by laying out this reminder of the gospel. There's that word justify. Justified. We've seen it in our New City Catechism the last several weeks, a few weeks back. Remember, we are justified when we come to faith in Christ. That means that we are declared righteous by God, which is made possible by Christ's death and resurrection for us. So if we are in Christ, when God sees us, we are justified. He sees the righteousness of Christ over our lives. He doesn't see our sin. Psalms tells us, he cast our sin as far as the east is from the west. He knows our sin no more. He sees the righteousness of Christ. Paul says that a person isn't declared righteous by the works of the law, but only through faith in Jesus Christ. So very important. It all comes down to faith in Christ over works. Quick aside for anybody in here or listening online that has not placed their faith in Jesus. No work that you do will earn you salvation. I don't care what you do. I don't care how many people you serve. I don't care what you do for the good of the community. I don't care what you do. If your mindset is, I am doing everything I can to make sure that God doesn't stay mad at me and I want to be right with Him, so I do, you're wasting your time. Those things are good. Serve others. Care for others. But if your faith is not in Christ Jesus, those works are for nothing. Because at the end of the day, if we come to the end of our life, no matter our age, and we do not have our faith in Jesus, the scriptures are clear, we will be separated from God for all eternity. There's no chance after we're dead and gone that something may happen and we can come back. And God can redeem us then. If your faith is not in Christ, you are dead in your trespasses and sins. And therefore, if you die, you are separated for all eternity. A place called hell that is horrific. No work that we do earns salvation. It is only by the work, the finished work of one, Christ Jesus, our Lord, who paid it all, who gave it all when he gave up his life on that cross after suffering over and over and over, beatings, mocking, flogging, nails driven feet into the cross, God's wrath poured out on him. All so that we could have redemption. How incredible is that? All so that we could have redemption. All so that we wouldn't have to go and do anything but say, God, I repent. I know who I am. I know how wicked I could be. Jeremiah tells us the heart is deceitful and wicked. Who can understand it? I know who I am. I know the weight of my sin. I need your redemption. I confess Jesus Christ as Lord. That's the gospel. That's what brings clarity. That is the good news. That is what brings salvation to all who repent and believe. Verse 17 tells us, but if in our endeavor to be justified in Christ, we were too found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. In his defense, Paul offers this hypothetical question. If we have faith in Christ, and then we are found guilty because we have abandoned the law, does that mean that Jesus led us into sin? Certainly not. Paul says, no, absolutely not. He continues in 18, for if I rebuild what I tore down, I prove myself to be a transgressor. The old way of doing things, the old way of living life, the old way of doing those things has been torn down. If we are to build the old system back up, doing all the works, guess what? We're still a sinner. We're still in need of redemption. It's pointless. Every bit of it is pointless because Jesus paid it all for anyone to repent and believe. Verse 19, for through the law I died to the law so that I might live to God. See, Paul is indicating that when he attempted to keep the law, it condemned him. Don't miss that. In his attempt to keep every bit of the law, it condemned him because he couldn't meet that standard. And Paul's not saying it just for himself, he's pointing it out for anyone. If you can't meet that standard, you're not going to be redeemed. Those Ten Commandments that I talked about, we've just said it a few moments ago, none of us have been able to keep them. We might keep one or two here or there, but then you go down the list, you're like, oh, I messed that one up. Hey, I hadn't murdered anybody. I'm good, right? Jesus made it clear. The way you think about someone in the heart. I haven't committed adultery to anybody. Yeah, what about that woman that you lusted after? It's the same thing. None of us can meet that standard. Paul is making it very clear. Paul's saying, hey, look, I died to the law. I died to the law. I stopped trying to do and meet all the requirements because regardless, I'm guilty. Therefore, I live for Christ. And he gets there and lays it out. The big old verse in verse 20. I have been crucified with Christ.
It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Paul says that he's been crucified with Christ. See, the same is true for us, church. If you are in Christ, you have been crucified with Christ. What do you mean? The old person is dead. The new person, Christ Jesus, lives inside of us. The Holy Spirit, we talked about it a few moments ago at the beginning of the gathering. The Holy Spirit, he indwells us. He convicts us. He comforts us. He guides us. He makes us a new creation. This is what we see and what we will see in 2 weeks when we have baptism. That baptism represents who we are prior to Jesus. It represents just like Jesus goes into the tomb, we go into the water and we come up representing the fact that we are a new creation. We have been made new all because of Jesus, nothing of the law, nothing of ourselves. It's the free gift that God has given to us. As we live this life in our flesh for the Lord, we do so in our faith in Jesus, the only Son of God. So what's he say next? He said, who loved me and gave himself for me. It's so good. You and I are worth it in the eyes of the Lord, despite our sin and shame. Despite our sin and shame that separated us, Jesus says, I don't care. I'll go. I'll die. You may think for a moment, maybe a thought comes in your mind, as it did me, and maybe it was just me, but as I was putting this together and I wrote that down, I was immediately taken to the garden. Right before Jesus is betrayed to be crucified, he sits there and he prays. And one of the things he says over and over is, Father, if this cup, the cup of his wrath, if this cup should pass me, then so be it, but not my will. Yours be done. You might say, well, that sounds like Jesus didn't want to die. But you got to think for a moment, guys. He's fully God. He's also fully man. He knows what is coming. But he also knows that there in that moment, in order for it to be accomplished, the Father's head has to be turned as the wrath is poured out on his Son. But despite all that, Jesus says, not my will. Yours be done. He also, in that high priestly prayer, he prays this beautiful prayer, and he prays for us. He prays for us. He prays for his followers that are there present, and he says that he prays for those who will come to know me because of their word. He's looking ahead, he's praying for us because we come to faith in Christ. We're on his mind there in that moment, but even while we're there, not even thought of yet, thousands of years ago, he still is willingly dying for Bryan Air. He's still willingly dying for fill in the blank with your name. Because of your sin and your shame, he willingly gives up his life. Last verse, verse 21. I do not nullify the grace of God. For if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. He puts the exclamation mark there at the end. He doesn't nullify the grace of God. In other words, he doesn't treat it as meaningless. Why? Because if keeping the law made us righteous, i.e. right with God, he says, then Jesus died for nothing. Do we believe that Jesus died for nothing? No. No. Son of God did not die for nothing. He died for you and I. He died for the sins of the world. Because the Father saw it necessary for redemption to be offered to the ones who sinned against Him. It plays out all the way from Genesis to Revelation. God's people honor Him. They sin against Him. God wants to bring down wrath. He relents. There are times when He does. But we see this over and over theme. Although we sin against Him, He still provides the mean of redemption. That's an incredible Father. That's the God we serve. So make no mistake about it. If for some reason your vision for how you're to live your life to be right with God was by doing this, 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 and this, abandon that and run to the only one who can redeem your soul. The only way that you can be saved, that's through Jesus Christ and His life that He gave up for us. That brings the clarity of salvation. So where does the gospel need to shine in your life today for some clarity? Think about that. Do you need the gospel to show you the reality of your sin and shame to confess Jesus and truly be saved? If that's you, praise God. Let's have a conversation. Are you saved, but you're wrestling with sin? Guess what? So are each and every one of us. But here's the thing. You need the gospel to confront you in that sin, provide clarity of how to walk in step with the Lord and do so. If you have questions about that, you need prayer for that, let us know. But one way or the other, we need to look and see how the gospel needs to bring clarity to our lives today. The bottom line again, the gospel brings clarity to all things. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we are so grateful for You. Lord, I'm so grateful for the fact that You are our Abba Father. And Lord, You have provided the means of redemption to all who would repent and believe. And Lord, we come to You at this moment, Lord, and wherever we may be at in the journey. Lord, if there's anyone within the sound of my voice that does not have a relationship with You, Lord, maybe this text today is provided, Lord, through Your leading, Holy Spirit, to bring about salvation for that person. Lord, maybe somebody is just wrestling with trying to do everything to meet this standard that they think they have to. They're trying to walk forward and do these things to follow the law. And it's getting them nowhere. Or they need You. So Father, I pray, Lord, that maybe today would be the day of salvation for them. That they would step out. They would place their faith and trust in You, repenting of their sin and confessing Jesus Christ as Lord. Lord, there may be those within the sound of my voice that they have the relationship with You. They know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. But Lord, maybe they just feel held down in bondage to sin. Maybe there's sin in their life that they need to confess and repent of, so they can walk in the way in which You've called them to walk and live. Lord, maybe there are brothers and sisters within the midst of us in our family, church family, Lord, that need to be confronted about some sin that they have. And maybe, Lord, we know it and we're fearful. We don't want to rock the boat. But Lord, we are doing a disservice to them, and ultimately we are being disobedient to you by not doing so. Lord, if that is us and we need to do that and minister to someone by coming to them about that, Lord, help us to do it with grace. Help us to do it with love. Lord, for everyone in my sound of my voice, Lord, that knows you, Lord, maybe we've just been living, showing a little bit of partiality. Maybe we've been living a way to where we're trying to walk the way over here because we don't want to get too dirty into the situations over there. Our King demonstrated for us that a dirtiness is where we need to be. Convict us, Lord, and draw us to the areas where we need to be. To get our hands dirty. To get in the midst of it. So that we can prayerfully lead people to know you as Father. But above all things, I pray now, as we sing this song, God, that you would have your way. We pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Would you stand with us?
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine I can sing, for it's mine. Not I, but through Christ in me. No faith is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor. It has been paid, for Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now through Christ in me.
with every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home. And day by day, I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to him. When the race is complete,
seat for a moment. Just a few quick announcements for you. One, our community group for the fall semester kicks off tonight at Pastor Walter and Kelly's house, and so we want to invite you guys to come out and join us at 5 o'clock. Kelly has made her spaghetti pasta, and oh, it's good. So come on out and enjoy it. It's going to be a great time together as we jump into this first week of our fall semester together. We are basically dissecting further the book of Galatians, and so it's going to be a really cool semester. We want you guys to come out and join us tonight. Secondly, I want to just show a quick video for you about the Janie Chapman offering, about a local church right here in our area that is a recipient through the offering. So let's watch that real quick.
So we are seeing record growth along the coast of our state. But because of this growth, and most of the folks that are coming in are not coming in looking for a church that's already there, they're just coming in to start a new life. So the need for planting the new churches in Charleston is great.
So 12 years when I said yes to God to become a church planter, there was a group of churches here in Charleston that really invested in me. And they had this vision of a church that planted other churches.
Kingdom Church is a church plant that was planted in January of 2024 in the Nexton community of Somerville. So I was on staff at Restoration for 6 years. It's been an amazing journey just being a part of Restoration Community Church and just learning from Adam. And it was just a great opportunity for me as a young up-and-coming pastor to be able to learn from somebody who was doing it and be a part of that type of a church.
So Joe Douglas comes on about 3 years into our church plant. I remember Joe Douglas said to me one time, because of his humility and his character, he said, I can see myself being here for 20 years just being the number two. And it speaks great to Joe's humility. But Joe is capable of so much more. And I know the Holy Spirit has to be behind that, and God's got to put a call in that. But Joe was wired to be a church planter. He was gifted to be a church planter.
And so we just felt like God might be calling us to plant there, and it has just been amazing since we got there.
So in 2024, Kingdom Church launches out with some of our very best staff members and some of our people as well, who we miss dearly, but we know they are answering God's call in their life. But yet we still continue to support them through prayer. We continue to support them financially. We're still challenging other churches to continue to give to the Janie Chapman offering.
Through that offering. Our church planters, right now there's 30 of them that receive monthly funding that come from those funds.
So we're just so thankful for all the support and the help and the people that have come alongside of us and helped us accomplish what God placed in our hearts. It does take faith, but it also takes a community of people who believe in what God wants to accomplish to make that accomplished.
As you can see, it's a tremendous blessing to be able to witness that. I see so many faces that I know in that video. Y'all may remember way back when I was sent out from Restoration to come here. And so it's just been really cool to watch how God has been doing that work and that we get to, through this offering, be able to support Kingdom Church in that way, as well as many other church planters and their churches. So prayerfully consider that our church goal is $2,000. You can give that throughout the month. It's for the month of September, so make note of that. And then two things. One, remember that we have our very quick family meeting just that we announced 2 weeks ago that we had to reschedule for today. Very quick about nominating. And so we just need to look at that real quick. Shouldn't take more than just a couple minutes. And then lastly, come on up here, bud. Walter's coming on down. So we told you at the beginning of the service, this was Corey, and I said that we would, you know, tell you a little bit more about him in a little while. Corey is a dear, dear man, and so we are so excited to bring him here. He is coming to join the church, and I'm going to let Walter talk about it because Walter's been pouring into his life, and they have a great relationship, and so I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Walter.
Well, it's an exciting few weeks for me. That first, we have the Sierras joined, who are my neighbors, and now we have Corey, who's a young man I've been walking with and encouraging and really getting encouraged by him and his love for the Lord. And Corey has decided that he would like to call Holmes Avenue home for the next few months. He finishes his time at Charleston Southern. He'll graduate in December, and this will be his home during that time period. We also have the joy of walking with him with an internship to help him further discover God's calling. You've seen some giftings of his through leading in worship, and we've got an opportunity to explore him preaching and teaching with us and just see what God is doing in his life and see how we can be a part of that. And so it's an exciting time to celebrate this, and I just simply want to ask if you are encouraged by what the Lord is doing and you want to affirm Corey joining our church as a member, if you would, raise your hand with me. So thank you. It's an incredible day to celebrate God's grace and mercy in the life of this church and what he's doing here at Holmes Avenue. We've told you September is an exciting month, that we've got yet another family who's going to be joining in a couple of weeks. We've got four baptisms with some more on hold right now. So it's an incredible thing that God is doing here, and I want you to just focus in on that, to rejoice in his grace and mercy. So if I could, can I pray for us, and then I would encourage you to come forward and greet Corey and just encourage him, welcome him to our family. If I could I pray for us? Father, thank you for what you've done for us today. Thank you for your grace and mercy and letting us worship you and celebrate your goodness, Lord. We're so thankful that you are a good God who gives clarity to his people. Lord, you show us the seriousness of our sin, and you show us how great the salvation you've offered to bring redemption to that sin. Lord, we rejoice over the good things you do for your people and bringing people like Corey to be a part of our faith family, Lord. It is our prayer that you would continue to work in our midst and that we would, one, see many people cross from death to life, celebrating the greatness of King Jesus, but two, that people would covenant with us to be a part of our faith family, to see our community and our world changed. Lord, we're grateful for you. We're thankful for the work you're doing in our lives. We pray that you bless this week and send us out to be a blessing. We pray these things in your name. Amen. We love you guys. Hope you have a great week.